I have a very important anecdote to start this video out with. Welcome to the video. I've been dieting, dropping weight, crash dieting, really pushing it. I finally reached the goal. I've lost 22 pounds in 104 days. That's about a pound every 5 days I've lost, about. And working out, running, doing, and my body just hit a wall yesterday. And I knew it was going to rain the next day. I said, I got to get out, play golf, and keep pushing. But I suddenly felt this feeling like, I can't do it. It's an intuitive feeling like this is going to be a disaster, and I was very nervous. Well, I ended up going out, and it was a disaster for sure. Cold weather, windy weather, no strength, no coordination. I played worse, maybe the worst I've ever played in my life, worse than the first time I ever played. I mean, it was just horrendous. But I still did a massive amount of running because cart path only, and I went up hills looking for ball. I just put an intense workout. But I couldn't play at all. I was terrible. And I was playing with these two gorillas, these two golfing gorillas. These guys were unbelievable. I have a little story there. Of this par five, they hit their tee shot. They're playing from the back. I mean, they just crush these tee shots. And then they get up there, their ball, and they take out their rangefinder, Bushnell rangefinder, and they look, and the guy says, 265 to the flag, 265. So they got these, they carry these irons with them. They look at their irons, which iron do I hit 265 with? Okay, I'm going to hit this one. And they crush the ball into the middle of the green, 265 uphill with an iron. These guys are like pro caliber distance. I mean, it was unbelievable. And I couldn't even hit the ball 10 yards. I couldn't get past the ladies' tee. It was just unbelievable. Quite an experience. However, okay. Now, did I panic? Did I get upset? No. And here is the analogy that I want to draw. This little anecdote is for the spiritual path. You work out, you're intensely working on all this, as which I am, and I hope all of you are as well. We should all be doing this right now. Intense work on the spiritual path. We're going to feel tired. We're going to hit the wow. Okay. And when the wow's so intense, we're going to feel like, I just don't get it at all. You know, I just can't do this. But you bounce back from that. Just so, if I had taken that and saying the golf said, oh my gosh, I can't play anymore, I've got to quit, this is horrible. I said, no, I know I've pushed myself to the absolute, I've never pushed myself this severely in my life. Combination of, I put a big push to drop extra 5 pounds, which I did, and just really, just weak and sore and doing, and, you know, just the most intense push, big push. Same spiritually. It's the same thing spiritually. We put on this very intense push, and we're going to feel deflated. We're going to feel like we're so non-functional. I felt like, but I did feel like an idiot. I just said, okay, it's not my day. And then we got to the turn, the 10th hole, and I said, guys, I'm going to go play the front nine again, because it was too slow on the back, and I said, see you later. They said, okay. And they were cool. They didn't ever say anything to me. These guys were in a league of their own. They're like professional quality, really, even though the course beat them up real bad, because the course is so brutally difficult. If you just miss shot any which way, you pay severely. But they were, the power, the display and everything was a very impressive. They just took tees they took irons off the tee from the back. I mean, they're hitting irons 290, you know, just ridiculous, or two whatever. Yeah. So it was a very good experience that when we are pushing ourselves towards realization, we're going to feel like deflated, like we just don't have it. We're stupid. You know, like that. And the world is so much smarter than we are, so much more powerful. But it's not. It's not like that at all. But this is why I said, talk about the wow factor has to be the managing success on the path. We have to be smart about it, have to realize that the efforts that we make exhaust us. It's very strenuous, very difficult. And we will go through these times when we feel like, you know, we just don't have it. We just don't have it. And then we just smile and just say, great, great. This, I'm getting a great workout. So I took it the right way. I said, Holy Spirit, thank you so much. You put me exactly the right place. This is wonderful. I get this experience with these guys, off the charts, players. Very rarely does that happen. And plus, I get to do all this running, cart path only. I hit the ball every which way. I was looking for golf balls here on this mountain, down on this gorge, running. I got an intense workout. And I took it the right way. I said, this is great. This is going to help me down the road. Just whenever you play with someone who's better than you, who's really good, you get something you take away. You take away something from that. And I held my head high, you know, the whole time. But they never said a word to me the whole time. And I was playing so fast, I didn't want to get in their way. I just, yeah, it was miserable. It was wet. It was muddy. It was just everything. It was terrible. So this world is real wet. It's like a golf course, a brutally tough course. It's wet. It's windy. It's muddy. It's miserable. And there are these strong, egotistical people running the show here, very much. Keep in mind, the ego is limited. It's inherent. It's the idea of limitation. So the ego wants to limit everybody else. It wants to control and limit everybody else. This is the ego. So we have these egomaniacs running the world who want to control us all and tell us what we can and can't do, limit us. It goes on and on and on and on and on. So they're large and in control, but they make a lot of mistakes. Like these two guys, they made a ton of mistakes. They really did. Even though the power display was incredibly impressive, and some of the stuff they did, it was really impressive. They were so good, but they still, I mean, they hit balls out of bounds because the angles on the course are so tough, and just a slight mishit, and there the ball's gone. And so, I mean, they didn't score that well. They hit a ball in a bunker, it plugs, they have to hit out sideways, it doesn't go out well. I mean, it's just brutal. So these people in the world, they seem large and in charge, but no, they're going to make all sorts of mistakes. They're going to have all sorts of troubles. Now, I could have played that if I was feeling strong and in sync, and I couldn't feel my body very well because I'm so light now. I had no sense of my body or the timing or anything because my whole body shape has changed. My whole, the way I feel, everything has changed. So I'm not in sync. I'm not used to it yet. But if I was in sync and used to it and focused better, and, you know, I could have probably scored as good as they did or not better. But who would ever think that, looking at the way I was playing there? But for me, I knew. I said, okay, this is just one of my exceptionally, this is an exceptional down day because of what I've been doing. So I was like pragmatic, wise and pragmatic. So on the spiritual path, we are going to suffer these low spots. Okay, absolutely we will. And it's very helpful to have those who have been gone through it so they can smile and be reassuring. Says, don't worry, it's fine. Everything, you bounce back. You're just getting used to a lighter sense of being, right? The sense of being is very light. And so we're not world beaters right now. We won't be world beaters maybe going forward. That's okay. It's okay. We need to get in great shape. So maybe the next 6 months, maybe we won't be world beaters. We'll be tired. That's fine. That's fine. I've been tired my whole life in pursuing this. I have not been a world beater at all. But how different it will be in the big picture, right? How complete world beater. Overcome the whole notion of the world entirely. So now another antidote which I have to bring up, which unfortunately never seems to get away from me. It's quite extraordinary. They hit this ball up on a hill. It's a very, very steep hill and rocky, loose rocks. And so they're climbing up on the hill. And I wanted to climb up this hill last time, but I didn't have. But now I had a perfect excuse. Oh, they're up there. So I get ready to run up this hill. And I said, wow, this is going to be a workout. And suddenly I look, and the guys up above me had dislodged these rocks, and these rocks were tumbling down the hillside right towards me. And so I did the splits and jumped up in the air, and the rocks went right between my legs. I was aware, I saw it, but I had the fitness to do that. I said, "Oh, I'll just jump in the air." I just jumped in the air before I couldn't have done that. And the rocks went past me like that, and boom, hit the golf carts. I said, "Whoa, there you go again. Rocks coming into the world. Danger for rocks." And the guy didn't really say anything. I yelled and I say, "Four," trying to make a little joke, like, "Hey, why don't you give me a heads up here?" He kind of said, oh, rocks," but he didn't. He should have said, "Look out." He didn't say anything. Kind of odd. Then later on, he's in his golf cart. They're talking about some. They're talking and joking about something else. But then out of his mouth comes, "They're coming! They're coming! They're coming!" Like that. It's like, and of course, I related it to the rocks. "They're coming! They're coming! They're coming!" Now, I don't know. Does that mean a rock? As in the country, as in that sort of social, political, global problem, that issue, or does it mean space rocks? I think it's probably maybe a combination of both, but the last thing in the world I was thinking about was rocks. Anything, and I want to get away from this. I can't get away from it. It is really extraordinary that this keeps being in every which way possible, and re-emphasize to me that rocks are coming. There's no question about it. So we should continue to push our spiritual efforts, even though we seem meek and lowly and humble, and I'm just a hacker. We're a hacker at life. I was a hacker out on the golf course. I really a severe hacker, like I'd never played before. That's how bad it was. And you might think after 40 years that'd be humiliating, but I know the game, and I understand that this is what happens. This can happen. It can happen to anyone, and it's okay. So in life, don't worry if you're down and you're just a hacker in life. I don't mean a tech hacker. I mean just you just can't hit the ball straight. I mean you just can't get it done like you think you should be able to. You're useless. You're not serving any purpose. You're not really a world beater. You're not really out there. You're a mover, not a mover and a shaker. You're not moving the ball out there. You're not compressing the ball of life. You're not compressing the world, this golf ball we're on. You're not getting it compressed and sending it out there and getting success and all this stuff. And that's okay. That's great. That's great. That's great. That means you're probably really, really, really working on the spiritual path. You're really working out. You're really getting it done. Rainy day today, cold day today. There's a cold front now. After this, it's going to be quite chilly. And that's okay, but I got it done before the rain. I got all this stuff done. I'm getting a lot of stuff done. And a lot of eye candy is I'm working on developing some eye candy for Christmas to try to combat all this attraction to eye candy for Christmas. Well, hopefully I'll have some. It hasn't worked out exactly the way I want to. A lot of technical problems, to say the least, but I'm trying to find workarounds for it all. And something should be coming your way. I don't want to promise anything, but we'll see. It could be coming your way. I've been working very, very, very strenuously on to help us, those who are taking the burden of the path, which is this insidious continuity fear, which has not been properly explained throughout history, which is why we failed. We haven't managed our success properly because we don't understand what the obstacles are all about. If we understood the obstacle being the continuity fear, then we would stick with the path. But too many people don't stick with it because they don't understand what the problem is. I think, well, I just got to meditate eventually. Well, yeah. But how do you keep motivated to keep meditating if you keep having these down periods? You think, oh, I just can't get it. It's the continuity fear. It's like working out. You get tired and have to let yourself recharge. And the continuity fear and the wow factor that hits us so strong. The combination of that continuity fear and the difficulty and then the wow factor of seeing truth, it sets us back. It slows us down. And it's very, very insidious. So smart isn't good enough. You have to have very skillful, artful means, very skillful means to keep managing success and navigating through. And it has to do with your will and determination and hindsight. And just like on that golf course, I said, okay, it's not my day. That's okay. I'm not going to get depressed. I didn't get depressed. I'm fine. Quite extraordinary. I'm gonna put that driver away though. You'd use the one I'm used to. Couldn't hit it, but so I'll make a few tweaks. I'll make a few little tweaks and be better than ever. Better than ever. And just the fact that I was able to jump over those rocks, that shows so something very interesting, is that the metaphor of having the necessary presence of mind and the spring. I said, oh, rocks. What can I do? Oh, I can jump. I can jump up in the air. And they'll go underneath me like that. You see, so we can make the jump. There's some sort of shift or jump that we can make. And so it may seem like we're not really large and living life large and loving it and in control of the world and really, right? But maybe we can shift off of the world, shift up into a higher realm, and the rocks won't touch us, that kind of thing. Not maybe, definitely will. Absolutely will. So, this isn't all. This isn't all. There's one other issue. I had a dream about maybe 3 nights ago that I haven't spoken of because I don't know what to make of it, and it's so hard to explain it. It was, if you remember the video, the Genghis Khan video, where I saw this the worst massacre ever possible, in the most extraordinary detail of all these corpses. Dead corpses draped everywhere, littered everywhere. Well, this one was a very similar dream. I came across this so-called spiritual teacher, and it was dressed kind of oddly, and sort of in like sort of tweedy, herringbone tweedy three-piece suit with gold-rimmed glasses, round gold-rimmed glasses. And then I saw this spiritual teacher, their history, or there's something about their resume or something. And I saw a picture of this teacher sitting in this landscape. And I was way up above. It was like a very large, wide-angle picture from above. And it looked down, and I looked down at this picture. And I saw all these corpses. It was like a vast archaeological dig almost. It seemed like that way. And some of the corpses had been unearthed, but many more I see was embedded in mud. This vast, I mean, you're talking about, I was just a corpse. It was like the mud was just completely saturated with corpses. Everywhere you looked, there was corpses. And they were all dressed. They were all like, had clothes on, but they had been like a mud flow had just encased them in this mud. And there's dirt, you know, they'd been there and they were just buried alive in all this mud. Buried alive in mud, all these corpses. And that was a very, very, very heavy dream. People still had their hats on, their suits on, their clothes, and yet they were just lying there, you know, like as if this massive mud flow had flowed over them, and that we've been digging, that someone had been digging in this area, unearthing these corpses. There were so many. And you're talking about hundreds and hundreds of thousands. It went on forever, it seems like. And how deep it went, I don't know. They dug down different layers in this archaeological dig, and wherever they dug, there were corpses. It was just so extraordinary. I can't even... you know, this is a dream that would freak the mind out, but it didn't freak me out. I just said, huh, interesting, okay. And just stayed positive about it. But there's a Santa Claus-like figure, actually, that teacher, come to think of it. Santa Claus doesn't use all these sort of gold spectacles and a beard and sort of, I don't know, it seemed like sort of a Santa Claus-like figure, this teacher. And then I was with this teacher, and I after I saw this, and then he sort of left me, and I realized something wasn't right. And then he said, well, at least you saw Wisconsin. At least you had seen Wisconsin. And I said, huh, Wisconsin, what does that mean? Play on words. Wise con, son. A wise con on the sun. Wisconsin, Wisconsin, sun. So we're wisely conning the Son of God, Spirit. We're conning ourselves, a wise con, a clever con. You say, well, at least you saw the wise con, Wisconsin. Well, okay. So it was like a false teacher, and it was a very odd dream. But I did not get rattled by it. Different than the Genghis Khan massacre. I forget the name of that city where it probably happened. But whereas millions of corpses, and they're in every type of clothing, all their clothing tattered, and the flesh rotting, their fences on trees, on houses, on streets, everywhere, just completely littered with every imaginable type of corpse and every sort of agonizing death. You know, that one kind of shook me up a little bit. This one, I kept my cool and said, okay, sort of. So, rather, why would such a dream arise? How could I possibly dream this? Where would that possibly come from? I don't want to dream something like that. I would never imagine something like that. What could it mean? It could mean some sort of massive what, pyroclastic flow of mud and debris burying everybody. It could come from an asteroid hitting the ocean and then the crust and ejecting massive amounts of material, raining down huge rains, to tsunamis and burying, I don't know, it something caused all these people to be entombed like this fast. I mean, this, you know, they had all their clothes on. This wasn't like this natural death. No one had died a natural death there, and all the corpses I saw, no. And they were respectable people, this was not the result of a battle either. These were wealthy people too. I mean, this was not a result of third world people dying from an epidemic or things like that. No, these were wealthy, well-dressed people, all suddenly buried like this. So, there you go. These are interesting anecdotes. And as much as I like to get away from all of it, it doesn't go away. It doesn't go away. The Holy Spirit is just pounding me with this issue. So I say, well, Holy Spirit, what do we do about it? I believe we need to convince ourselves that we can function in a higher realm, or that we'll be welcome in a higher realm. And I did have a dream years ago, the seminal dream about all this showing what's going to happen, the rocks coming into the world and the dust and everything. I fled to another resort, another place, and I said, do you honor, you know what happened? Can I stay? They said, of course, we know what happened there. Yeah, we're very much aware of what happened where you were living. And we've made preparations ahead to have refugees come here and stay here. And you're more than welcome. We're delighted to have you here. Stay as long as you want. That's what I was told. And I said, wow. And what I found out was this place that we're going to is way better than this world, actually. And I felt like, wow, do I even deserve to be here? You know, this is like so extraordinarily nice. So I would say that part of the practice that we're doing, along with the illumination, along with realization, along with non-dual abidance, is to get used to something better than this world, something, you know, really, really, really great in terms of the beauty of it all. And so these graphics that I'm doing, this is an important part of preparation. Certainly, the graphics I've been looking at last couple days are quite extraordinarily beautiful. And just getting used to that, I believe is very helpful. I've said, like, going out on these, like, some of the most beautiful golf courses in the world, which I've been out on, you just feel like, do I really belong here? This is so beautiful. I mean, why? I can't play that well. I mean, you wonder. So if you're seeing this, grass, you say, do I really deserve this beauty? I mean, well, of course we do. We're perfect. We're spirit, we're the extension of God. The perfect, the all perfect, without any exception. And so, it's just a matter of homework. Do your homework. Do your homework. The ones that will jump up, be able to jump, are the ones that did their homework. God, I was notorious in school for never doing my homework. Why? Because I knew there was another type of homework that I needed to do, and I started working on that. I said, to heck with it. I know there's going to be trouble coming in the world. These people don't realize this. So they're having me do this homework, and I know that's not where it's at. So I'll take the bad grades, which I did. I'll take the bad grade, and I said, because I want to be ready. I don't want to be a prosperous fool. I don't want to be a prosperous fool and get buried. Don't be a prosperous fool. Do your homework. Let us all do our homework. So I'm working on these videos, trying to get them ready. Not many people watch them, but I'm emphasizing that these graphic video, these videos with the graphics. They're beautiful graphics. It's the grace. Now, I want to say something else. It's very important here. So let's lay it out clearly. The worst insult you can ever give an artist or somebody is to say, "Oh, how did you do that? Oh, gee, how did you do that? Can you explain the details of how you did this?" That's the biggest insult possible, of course, because you're denying that it's art. You're denying the purpose of it. You're denying, in other words, that the message didn't get through, is what you're saying, is what's being said. Now, this is what I've experienced in my life. People say, "Oh, it's so beautiful. How did you do that? How did you make those slides? How did you do..." Instead of experiencing what the purpose is. See, art has a purpose. Art has a purpose. Just like music, I tried to make beautiful music last lifetime. The purpose was to try to get us ready for something better. The same thing this lifetime. The purpose is to get us ready, get us familiar with something better. So we say, "Oh, I can handle this. I know I can handle this. I'm used to this. I've already been exposed to this. I've already gotten used to it. So I believe I can get used to this wonderful, wonderful realm I'm in now." That's the purpose. So the artists have an urgency about them. They're very creative. They're very helpful. They have an urgency. It's about the message and the pragmatic helpfulness of the art, not about how they did it. Don't ever ask the artist how they did it. That's the terrible insult, really. And because the fact is, the answer is, I did it with love. Love did it. See, I had the will and the compassion and the love to say, I want something to happen to help. And so the Holy Spirit just helped me out. It's the Holy Spirit did it. Love and the Holy Spirit, compassion. That's what did the art. Okay, I just was willing to go along with it. And that's the whole answer. I mean, when I'm looking at these graphics and everything, I put everything together, I don't know how I did it. I can't even remember how I did it. Sometimes I wonder, how in the world did I do this? I don't remember. That's okay. I say, that's okay. It doesn't matter. It's here. It's inspiration. It's spiritual inspiration. The ego always says, "Well, how did you do that?" That's the ego. That is the ego. The ego doesn't want to focus on the message. It doesn't want to be helped past. It doesn't want to be helped because its goal is failure. Its goal is limitation, separation, limitation, failure. Failure to recognize that we're perfect and unlimited. We're the center without any circumference. Okay, we're the center without any circumference. I remember there was this big egotistical spiritual teacher in the world that we all suffered from, apparently. And if I'm mistaken about this, then I'll have to retract. But this is the impression that we got. And I had a dream about him in the 80s. And It was something like he was coming out of the bathroom or something, a public bathroom, and there's a tile wall there or something. And he was all, like, smiling and fired up and full of bliss and active bliss. Like, ah, I'm so spiritual. I'm on fire. It's great. And he saw me, and he said, and then he drew this circle on the wall. He drew this circle on a wall. He said, this is what I'm about. The circumference, encirclement. Okay, and I looked at him and I said, and then I put a point in the middle and I said, that's what I'm about. And the truth is that we are the center without any circumference to us whatsoever. We are the center. We are the now. We are the here now. We are all, consciousness is all, always the here now without any boundaries, without any circumference whatsoever. This is the truth. When we think about the past, when are we thinking about it? Right now. When we think about the future, when are we thinking about it? Right now. When we're thinking about over there, where are we thinking about it? Where is that? It's right here. It's right now. It's in our consciousness. It's in our awareness. It's always right here, right now. We're the center without any circumference. We're a point without any circumference. So this teacher was trying to encircle us, saying, I am the circumference. I am what, and he, of course, went on to claim he's God. That he was God, and no one can be higher. He's, no one can even reach this. He's the circumference. But God is not like that. God is the center without any circumference. Perfect freedom. Perfect freedom. Now, maybe, hopefully, he went on to recognize it. He clarified, I don't know. Didn't seem that way, but we do get spiritual egotists in this world now and then, and we do have to battle through it. And this, we have to. Unfortunately, we have to get past spiritual egotism. We have to get past it, and it's difficult. It's difficult. As Ramana Maharshi said, it's the great stillness, it's the great peace. It is beyond, even beyond this fiery bliss. And this is what the great teachers tell us. The Shakti is not where it's at. It's beyond the Shakti, it's beyond this activity. The base, the baseless base, the fact is everything is the base. We are the base, all is the base, and the base is all. There's only the base. This is true. There's only the base. Now, just like these beautiful graphics, I'm trying to put some beautiful little snippets of non-dual truth with these graphics. I did in one video. I was able to do this. I hope it turns out okay. I don't see why it won't. I'll try to get that one up. Get it available to you. It's little snippets, beautiful graphics with little snippets, and you just get used to it. Don't worry about the intellect. The intellect's the ego. We don't have a circumference. The intellect is this belief in a circumference, a boundary, that we're contained. The base is not contained. What contains the base? Does the base contain the base? No. There's only the base. And this is completely abstract. We cannot conceptualize this, which is why we have to experience it. This is why the great teachers say, you know, this is, encourage us to go further and experience it. It's completely abstract. It's only the base. There's only spaciousness. All appearances are just a spaciousness appearing to, as spaciousness. And so these little snippets, I put these little snippets in, just allow, get used to it. Just say, ah, that's beautiful too. The graphics are beautiful. The little snippet is beautiful. I like this. Graphics are beautiful. The little snippet is beautiful of truth. This, I believe, will be very helpful for us. Even though we might feel, oh, we're not getting anywhere. Where's the rhetoric? I can't, you know. We think that we need to be some rhetoricians, rhetoricians. I'm not sure which way. And that we need to set the world on fire. No, we need to prepare. And how do we prepare for something better? Familiarity. I say over and over and over, familiarity is decisive. Sounds like the rain is back, I believe. Or is that just the wind? Well, we're getting a little bit of rain in California. Not the big storms. This is just moderate amounts of rain coming. But hopefully the storms will be... I expect storms will be coming late December, then January, February. We're going to get inundated. I really expect it. If we can shift... Now, rhetoricians, however you pronounce it, we don't need to be that. We don't need to be that. We don't need to be that. And so we may seem incompetent compared to these whiz kids who are out there, love, you know, peace, love, this, blah. They seem to be able to talk the game, you know, talk a great game, and they're changing the world and all this kind of stuff. The Holy Spirit keeps emphasizing to me the shift into a higher realm. Certainly the prophecy in the Bible emphasizes this too. But not that I get it from there. These are actual experiences I have. I mean, you know, bighorn sheep knocking rocks down on me from this cliff, knocking them down right behind me. And I was like, boom, 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 big boulders coming down. I said, oh my gosh. Right at the place where I dreamed about years ago, that very wall, they were knocking rocks off of that wall. The very same walls. The synchronicity was out of this world. You couldn't write a script like this. That's what I saw in a dream. So, here the bighorn sheep are knocking it down. The duelists, two big horns. We don't have to be world beaters in terms of trying to impress the ego with our skills. We're not here to impress the ego. We're here to get used to something better. Okay, now, this is very, very important. We're not here to impress the ego of how smart we are, anything like that. This is the key concept ultimately as far as being humble, meek and humble. Jesus emphasizes this, and all the teachers, great teachers, emphasize this, the humility, the meekness. I went out there and I played golf so terrible that it was laughable, and yet, you know, I just accepted. I said, okay, it's okay. And fortunately, those guys they didn't smirk or laugh or make any comments. They just didn't pay any attention. It was very cool. They were very cool about it. I thank them for that. I'll pay them back somehow someday. But, you know, they were so good that it's hard to relate to, you know, they just don't relate to the average golfer. They were on a different level as far as that goes. But they were fine. They never laughed. I laughed or said, wow. No comments. Didn't pay any attention. Thank you. But we don't need to be these world beaters. We don't need to impress the ego. We can be humble. And, of course, the ego look at us and smirk and say, phew. You guys got no game at all. I mean, what are you guys? What are you, crazy higher realm? That's hilarious. Got no game. Well, guess what, ego? We don't have to impress you. We're not playing the game of impressing the ego. Okay? We don't play that game. We play the game of familiarity, which is the only game there is in terms of pragmatically, because this is what is causing us the problem. I'm going to shift things here. See, the light keeps shifting a little bit. If I get the better contrast here. We don't have to play that game. There's no need to play the game of impress the ego. There's no need for that. But because of the insidious inference that reality is no longer real, we have a need to get familiar with what is significantly better than this inference, an inference of reality instead of inference of non-reality. So familiarity wins this game. So we're playing a different game than the ego's playing. The ego keeps thinking that we're playing its game. No, we're not. We're pretending like we are because it gets so agitated if we don't. But we're really not playing the ego's game. We're playing a different game. So that's why the ego says, well, how did you do that? You're so clever. Can you impress me? I'm not here to, an artist is not here to impress you with the cleverness. It's really not true. They're there, the art is there to, as a reminder and as a familiarity, tool of familiarity with something ineffable, with something glorious, with something that is higher, with something that is better. Something that references reality. This is what the art is for. If it does that, then it serves its purpose. Art, then that's it. That's all the artist wants to do, is does the art serve its purpose? Not, gee, look how clever I am. It's just a blessing. The Holy Spirit said, why don't you try this? Why don't you try it? I just said, okay, I'll try. Oh my gosh, that's beautiful. Wow. Wow. Thank you, Holy Spirit. But the ego keeps trying to teach us how to be clever, because the ego thinks we need to change reality. Now, another tangent here, another focus here, to keep things briskly moving along. Been having difficult nights, getting disturbed, waking up at 3, 4 in the morning, can't sleep, various reasons why. And got very agitated after the third time and third night in a row. Very upset. But I said, I decided, let me just see if I can look to see what this is about and how can this help me. So I had to use an great effort of will to reel in the agitation. And then when I did that, I got into this meditative, contemplative insight mode. And what I saw, I've never seen before, and therefore it's not so easy to describe. I've never heard anybody really talk about it. The only one who's even remotely talked about something like that is George Gurdjieff. Georgie Gurdjieff. Tales of Beelzebub and everything else or something. The Tales of Beelzebub is all about the world or something. And he talked about how bodies... the world here and bodies are just food, that were being used as food to stabilize the moon or something like that. He had some theory about this. I thought, that's a little crackpot. I mean, but I said, why did he say this? This is very odd. However, what I saw was much, much, much clearer than this. And it's really quite extraordinary. And I could just mention it in passing here, because it's so far out of the mainstream of anything that we'll just have to, kind of, most people say, well, it's just, you know, I can't really go with that. It's too out of the mainstream of any spiritual teaching I've ever heard. But I saw it, and I believe it's absolutely true, is that Jesus tells us this electromagnetic universe or realm is completely false. It's not true light. He says it is of the light, because all appearance is of the light, but it's an attempt. What we're trying to do, we're trying to change reality. And what we're trying to do is we're trying to say that God is consumable, that we can eat God. Okay, this is what we're trying to do. And this whole electromagnetic universe and setting up worlds and people, we as humans are consumers, and we're like consuming the light of the sun, turning it into food, and then eating the food. And the belief is that this transforms the light, that we're transformers, that we're transforming light itself, changing it. So the whole world is like this transformer. And of course, humans are the most successful consumers in history, which is why there's so many of us. And what if you look at the world pragmatically, what are we doing? We're consuming. We're consuming goods. We're consuming food. We're consumers. We're eaters. And I saw that we're literally eating this electromagnetic light. That's how we're set up to do. And we believe that by eating this, it changes the light. And we think that this electromagnetic universe is God. It's not. And not exactly. Of course, nothing is really happening at all. But in our dream of this electromagnetic universe that Jesus says, not really the light that I'm talking about at all. And he says it's an attempt to change the light. And by eating it, we think we're consuming it, we're eating it. So this is why we're eaters. This is why all these life forms, we call it, are what are they? They're consumers. If you look, the amoeba, the bacteria, they eat, they consume at microscopic, miniature levels, all the way up to humans, the ultimate consumers. The food, look at the food chain. Everyone's eating everything else. I always wonder, why is this nature like this? I hate it. It's crazy. I hate predation. I hate the food chain. I hate consumption and eating. It's bizarre. If you look at eating, it's completely bizarre. What in the heck? People taking dead chickens and eating their muscles, you know. I mean, what the heck is that? It just freaks me out. I pretty much am just on a liquid diet now. It's water. Even that's odd. I find the whole body completely bizarre. Absolutely bizarre. There's no consumption in reality. Nothing's being eaten. This dream of eating is a dream. And yet there's a purpose to it. We think we're eating God. And therefore transforming God and changing God into something else. And then suddenly I realized, bingo, oh my gosh, Catholicism, eating, Christianity really, eating the flesh of God. We think by doing that, that's what they do. They go and they eat the flesh of God. I said, wow. I've always said, you can't do that. God's not flesh. They said, no, hypostatic, two natures. God is both spirit, formless, and form, flesh. And we can eat the flesh. And by eating the flesh, we are transforming. This just plays into what I saw. I realized this is the whole purpose of this electromagnetic universe. That's not reality at all, electromagnetic universe. Not at all. Jesus said, imagine the wind as free as can be. And imagine condensing that wind down and slowing it down into this completely solid, frozen chunk of immobility. And says that, but even more than that, you can't imagine. That's what this electromagnetic universe and our experiencing here is like, he says, compared to what reality. Reality is absolutely free. Freer than the breeze, he says. Completely freer than the breeze. And yet, we are trying to change it. So we imagine it's not free at all. It's frozen down like electromagnetism. He says like it's frozen light. Light just gives us the appearance of being frozen. Light is not frozen at all. It's an appearance in light, in spaciousness. So this is what non-dual teaching is about. It's saying, despite appearances of crystallization, nothing is ever crystallized. And so it's like a dream of crystallization, but it hasn't crystallized. So you might say the electromagnetic universe doesn't really exist at all. It doesn't really exist. It's only an appearance in pure spaciousness, spaciousness appearing to spaciousness, light appearing to light. So this insight, I realized, wow. But I was fine with that. I said, what did I practice? I said, this is the new normal. This is the new normal for me. Recognize that now this is the new normal. So I advocate this to all of us, is when you have a breakthrough, which you will, breakthroughs, you say, this is the new normal. Just keep saying, okay, I accept this as my new normal. I'm just going to get used to it. This is the way to do it. I can, I will, I've already made it my new normal. I can make it my new normal. I will make it my new normal. I've already made it my new normal. And just have confidence that you will do so. And you won't freak out. You won't think I need to impress the ego. I'm just getting used to it. So we're spending all our time having breakthroughs and getting used to these breakthroughs. And no time hardly at all impressing the ego. And so the ego says, well, there's nothing here. You know, this isn't impressive. Well, right, we're not trying to. We're trying to have breakthroughs. The more abstract our mind is, the more comfortable we are with abstraction, the more breakthroughs we're going to have. So we have to accept this and realize we will have breakthroughs. It's inevitable. So this is the new normal for me, that this consumption. And this explains why are we such insane consumers, and we can't seem to stop. And it's true. Because that's the whole purpose. They said, the ego said, be fruitful and multiply. We need as many consumers here in the world as possible, because you're eating. eating light, eating electromagnetism, isn't it? I mean, don't all the plants put electromagnetism into some form? And then doesn't everyone eat the plants? The animals eat the animals. Everything here is a form of electromagnetism, and everything here is eating everything else and consuming everything else, right? And the world is the great consumer through death, right? It consumes the trees. All the trees die, they fall down. What's consuming? The earth is consuming it. The elements are consuming. This whole realm of nature is just a consumption mechanism, actually. It's putting electromagnetism into different formats, and then consuming it. And the idea is that this is going to transform reality. So I saw that and I said, wow, this is top-notch insight. Top-notch insight. And you just don't hear this. I really don't. As I said, the only thing I've ever heard of something like this is Gurdjieff, along those lines. But not, this is just a clear, total picture of the whole situation. Just, I've never heard this before. And you know, I was just looking at it, I was just seeing it. And I said, wow, this is true. So I said, okay, this is a new normal for me. Fine. It's all good. It fits. It feels right. It feels normal for me. It feels fine. I'm comfortable with it. Okay. But when we have breakthroughs, just focus on making it the new normal. Don't struggle to try to put in a format to impress the ego. The ego wants you to format it so it's consumable. All right? Hello? The ego says, yeah, but can you eat it? You know, it's like reality. I realize reality. The ego says, great, but can you eat it? No, it's inedible. Uneatable. It's formless, uneatable. Baseless base. The ego says, well, that's no use then at all. You know, that doesn't help us. It doesn't help us. Well, we don't need to be helped. We don't need to be eaters. We don't need to be consumers. We don't need to be helped in that regard. So, again, when we have breakthroughs, the ego is going to say, yeah, but is it edible? And then you think, oh, I got to put it in some edible format. What do I do? Oh, my gosh. How do I do that? It starts struggling. No, I just say, no, I'm going to make this the new normal for me. That's all. So I haven't been struggling with this insight at all. I've just been saying, this is the new normal. Let me see how I feel with this insight. And so far, beautiful, no problems. No problems at all. They just say, okay. I didn't even say anything about it for several days. I said, let this settle in. Let it settle in, see how I feel about it. I feel fine. So ultimately, when we have the resistance from the ego, we're in non-dual abidance. The ego will say, well, that's great, non-dual abidance. Yeah. Okay, what's the format? I mean, how can I eat it? And then when you start, you know, say, well, there's nothing to eat, the ego says, well, what are you talking about? That's useless then. It's not, must, if it can't be eaten, it doesn't exist. This is the ego. If it can't be eaten, it doesn't exist. We're all these obsessive eaters, aren't we? I notice people are just so obsessed about food. And I talk about it because everybody's obsessed about it. And so I need to address this in a humorous way. I haven't already been eating anything. I just have a protein drink smoothie, some berries and protein drink, and just blend it up together, and that's it. It doesn't look like anything in particular, like you're drinking mud or something. But it just takes away food consciousness, which is great. People are so much into the body, how the body feels, food, because they think my job is to consume, my job is to eat. Now, there have been great teachers in the world who didn't eat anything, or didn't need, they said, I don't need anything. Ananda Mayama was the one, she said, I don't need to eat anything. But because you freak out if I don't eat, I'll eat. But she eventually made a deal, and she ate a grain of rice a day. For a long time, just one grain of rice. One had to be perfectly pure, and they couldn't have dropped. I mean, she put them through all this like rigmarole. about the grain of rice. And she ate a grain of rice a day, and it was fine. She says, actually, she said, look, the body can just absorb essence through spaciousness, really. She said, you don't need to eat at all. No, you don't need to eat at all. And I saw this in the inside. I said, wow, we don't really need to eat at all. It's true. It's just a dream. This whole thing of consuming is just a dream. We just, as Jesus said, we've projected all these needs upon the body. The body doesn't need to eat. That is true. But you can't force the issue by just not eating and thinking that, you know, that's putting the cart before the horse. You have to see the clarity and insight and have all the breakthroughs and normalize it, etc. This is the way to go. You can never force the issue by starving yourself. It doesn't work. Mahatma Gandhi tried that. It didn't work. But those who realize they don't need to eat, they eat just so others can feel comfortable. You know, make them feel a little more comfortable. Because they said, if you don't eat, you're going to starve. You're going to die. Oh, please, please, yeah, don't do this. This is terrible. So, okay, give me a grain of rice. The other time she was, I'll eat one fruit a day, but the fruit has to fall naturally from the tree. It cannot be picked. And I'll eat like a mango or something, and that's it. Don't need to eat. Don't need to consume. Nothing. Reality cannot be consumed or eaten. There's nothing edible. It's only isness. But again, the ego is saying, well, can you put that in an edible format for me, please? How can I consume it? So these graphics, you might say, well, how can I eat this? How can I consume it? That's the ego. Don't think that way. Think, just feel like, ah, this is beautiful. This feels like it's higher. It's ineffable. There's some quality of ineffableness about it. It's reminiscent. It's an echo. It's an echo of reality. It infers reality somehow. So I'll just get used to it. It's like a song. I know so many songs. It used to be a human jukebox. I'm not up to date anymore in doing it. But really, I just could listen to the radio, top 40, then the oldies radio, and I had a guitar, and I just played every song that came on. I'd play the song and sing it. And how do you do that? Well, by listening over and over. I found I had to listen, in order to get the lyrics of a song, I had to really pay attention, and there's a way to do it. And I figured out how to do it. It wasn't easy. But you have to drill yourself over and over and over, and then once you get the lyrics, you got the lyrics. And I don't quite remember now, it's a time, ultimately you start getting rusty. But you know the lyrics, and then you know the song, and you're familiar with it. But it takes more than one go-around with a song. And I could do it again. I mean, I could do it again. I don't want to do it right now. I don't want to focus on the songs. At one point, I was going to just be a human jukebox. You see these human jukeboxes that you put some money in, they'll play any song you ask. Like that, I was going to be like that. I really, really had all the guitars and practice for so long. And, you know, you call out a song, I can play it, I could sing it. And I thought this would inspire people. Of an echo of inferring something, that God hasn't forgotten our song, the song of freedom. See, God hasn't forgotten the song of freedom. And God has kept that song for us, because we are an extension of God. We haven't forgotten either, but we have this insidious continuity fear issue inferring that we've forgotten it. So I was thinking, maybe people, this would help people realize, hey, that God hasn't forgotten the song of freedom, the song of love, the song of perfection. But it didn't go anywhere. I was singing in this Catholic church, this chapel that nobody went to, and finally someone told me, well, we don't do those kind of songs here. And it kind of had made me realize that's not what they were about. And gradually I got eased out of that. I don't know if that's a good thing or not, actually. because I would have been fabulous at it. But I don't think people, I don't think it really reminds them enough. It's kind of like a mainstream wide thing, but I'm not sure that elevates enough. You get the elevation that you put into it, as far as, right? So you have to really make an effort to say, I am going to be inspired by this. I'm going to allow the inspiration to sink in. It's going to be part of me. This is why I was on the little mini vacation I had. I went to this golf course twice because the first time was so beautiful. I said, I have to go back and let it sink in some more. I would have done it 3 days in a row, but I was too tired. But twice was pretty strong. I realized once isn't enough. Twice, three times. Really, really watch it. Now, this isn't happening because of the view count. I can tell it's not happening. Maybe there's a few people viewing several times. That's possible. But if you really want to get it, this is what's necessary. Just like trying to learn the lyrics to a song. And this is the chorus. Learn the chorus. Nail the chorus. Okay, because the chorus is going to happen a couple times. Nail that. Get it. So you know the chorus. And then there's the verses. You know, the verses, this one, two, three. And learn the structure of the song. This is the structure. This is the way it's structured. The chorus and this. Okay, and then before you know it, I learn the song. It gets easier and easier and easier. Yeah, those were good times. I had this $30, I found this $35 candy apple red Fender Stratocaster cheap knockoff replica or something. It was like that. $35 with these very bendy strings with this cheapest electric guitar. I didn't even plug it in. I just played it acoustically. And that worked fine. Worked fine. Years and years and years and years just sitting, listening to the oldie station, learning getting all these songs, figuring out how to play all these songs, but it was never utilized. Interesting. Had a recording studio, tried to get people interested in this, that, you know, this will help the world. Now, the world is into consumption. He wants ever new consumption. Consume, 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 consume. But we're talking about inspiration, inspiration, inspiration. Reality's not consumable. There's nothing to consume. How do we consume pure spaciousness? How do we eat pure spaciousness? We're saturated inside, outside. There's no inside or outside. There's only the saturation everywhere. No circumference to it. We realize in abundance that there's nothing to eat, and the ego is like, oh my God, how can I live if I can't eat? But really, what we call this life of consumption isn't a life. It's attempt to transform life. So the ego is saying, how can I transform life if I don't have anything to eat? Well, we don't need to transform life. There's no necessity to it. It's a mere whim. It's a mere whim. Golden State Warriors, funny thing. I'm driving back from golf. If you can call it that. I didn't play golf. It was a debacle. And I said, I never listen to the radio anymore. I don't follow the sports. I'm not watching. I'm aware of it. You know, in the paper, I look at the sports section of the paper. So Warriors won again. Okay, they've won 24 games in a row. Actually, going back last year, 28 games in a row. And said, okay, maybe I'm going to listen. Maybe this will be part of this, help the streak along. So I turn on the radio, I'm listening. Then I suddenly realize, hey, you know what? I think they're going to lose tonight. I think I just jinxed them. I shouldn't have turned it on. So I turned it off. And then I got home and turned on the television again. And again, they were behind. And I said, they're going to lose. As soon as I pay attention, they're going to lose for sure. And ultimately, they lost. And I said, I really did jinx them. Well, it was a bad day for the Warriors. They were tired. They were tired. This is a team that's won 24 consecutive games to start the season. They were on the seventh game of a road trip. No team has ever swept a seven-game road trip in the history of the NBA. 283 times they've had a seven-game road streak or more, and no one has ever swept one. So they're on the seventh game of this brutal seventh-game road trip of just flying all over the country. They were injured, and they were tired, and I felt they're going to lose, and they did. Does that make them a lousy team? No. They're just tired. They'll bounce back. And so for us, when we're on this brutal push to jump over the rocks, and so we may have some rough spots, and we may not feel so great. We may not feel like world beaters, or we may feel, oh, wow, I'm just so tired. Well, that's okay. As the headline in the paper said, you can't win them all. They lost the game. They're now 24-1. You know, boo-hoo. We'll see how they do when they're all healthy and rested. We'll see how it goes then. So, I'm going to give myself a couple days to recuperate, or maybe even eat something. Or drink something. I had a Old Wallop chocolate protein drink this morning. It's good. Had an egg and toast. How about that? Consumed something. Ate something. So even the Warriors have their down nights. So we'll have down times, but celebrate the down times, because that just shows you what a great streak you've been on. That's all. Probably tired because you've been, you know, beaten up on the world, throwing the ego away, pushing the ego aside. And tired from that, and having great insights, and extraordinary insights, and breakthroughs. So yeah, we get a little tired. This is called managing success. The big part of managing success is recognizing that you'll have these, you'll feel tired, you won't feel totally sharp and on top of it, and thinking that I really got it. You'll have those phases. And just recognize, say, okay, this is just a phase. I'll be fine. I'll bounce back from this. And then just stay in stride. Just ease off a little bit. I'm not going to run today. It wore me out. I'm tired. I'm not going to swing weights around. I'm tired. Take it easy for several days, probably. Maybe 3 days. And just see how I feel. Eat a little bit and stretch and probably bounce back great. I know I will. Same thing, spiritual path, same thing. You'll bounce back. The more effort you put into it, the more backlash arises, of course. And the more strain of a continuity fear and the strain of new familiarity, new territory is a strain. New territory is a strain, no question about it. You listen to a new song, say, I got to learn this song. Oh, wow, yeah, I'm not used to this song. Okay, how does it go? And we figure out. And it's a determination. If you say, I have to learn this song, let's say you're in a dance band or something. You have to learn the song. Well, you got to learn it. You got to know it. So it's that, or you're out of the band. So you put your full attention on it. Now, non-dual truth is the expressions of it are different than what we're used to. We're not familiar with it. We're not familiar with it, so there's this period of time of effort and intensity, and we're not trapped by the rhetoric, non-dual rhetoric. We understand we must manage our success along with the non-dual rhetoric. We must also manage our success, and you can't just say, well, do some clever thing, well, there is no success, and then think that realizing there's no such thing as success means there's no success. Means there's no wow reaction. Of course there's a wow reaction to realizing we don't need any success. Of course there's a lack of familiarity, there's a familiarity issue. We're so familiar with thinking, it's like, oh, I don't need to eat. It's like, oh my gosh, I don't need to eat. Oh, of course there's a shock, like, what? I don't need any success. What? There's a wow shock to it. So we have to manage the wow. the success of realizing there's no success. And it's not a paradox at all, because we plug in the continuity fear and the familiarity issue. It's not a paradox. It's not a self-contradicting paradox in the slightest bit. The ego leaves out continuity fear. You'll notice this. This is why it's not talked about in this world. It rarely, because the ego has to leave it out. Otherwise, it's finished. It's finished. That's why when the Holy Spirit came to me in 1978 and said, "You're going to succeed, don't worry," it showed me that there's this issue of continuity, fear, familiarity. That's the only issue there is, the only problem there is. And we'll just work at it, and gradually you'll get familiar, and then you can't be stopped. I knew I would succeed then at that point. It's just a matter of working at it. So the ego, I said, "It's finished." I realized it's finished. It can't stop me. Because I'm looking at it from the standpoint of familiarity. This is the Achilles heel of the ego. Familiarity is the Achilles heel. So of course it leaves this out. It will talk nonstop, high, non-dual, blah, 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 blah. But it leaves out the issue of familiarity. Now, you wonder about, well, what about, you know, radical Dzogchen and all this? Where's the familiarity? Where's the continuity? Well, keep in mind that they said this teaching is only for a few fortunate few who really have very keen understanding, meaning they understand managing success on the spiritual path, how to manage the wow. That's a given. And then this teaching then helps us get the flavor of reality, as it were. This is why. So, this is why I'm able to give it out, this teaching. This is why Longchenpa showed up and gave a transmission of spaciousness to me. Really, I've never experienced pure spaciousness until that dream that he showed up that night after I prayed for help. He showed up that very night, and that very next morning I had the experience of pure spaciousness. I said, "Oh, this is it. How easy, how simple. I never saw this before. It was amazing." And this has faded, so I don't have the experience right now. But clearly it was because from Longchenpa's. Clearly that the correlation is absolutely clear there. So he's saying, okay, you have the capacity to work with this and get with it. And so it's okay for me to talk about this and give this out, because I'm putting in the right context of continuity fear. This is a problem we have. And of course we have to manage our success in recognizing we don't need any success. It's a shock. And there's not a lot of people that are getting with this, which I guess you'd expect, because it's only the best and the brightest and those who have this abstract capacity, inner capacity, for the wow, to recognize the wow and hurry up and wait. Right? Hurry up and wait. That's the only way to deal with it. Hurry up and wait. And that's what we're doing. So the Longchenpa doesn't so much talk about the continuity issue, really. What his focus is this way of echoing, as it were, reality. Is a brilliant artist, a poetic artist, actually. Really, in the echelon of you know, unsurpassable echelonness, so to speak. That when you're that talented, you don't evaluate. Forget it. Forget the evaluation. Throw it out. Throw the evaluation out. He's in that echelon where you don't even evaluate him as an artist. You just realize this is a high art of echoing reality to us, and just enjoy it and just benefit from it. That's all that he wants. Just benefit. This is my heartfelt desire for everyone, right? And you could feel that this is what he desired. This is his heartfelt desire for everyone. Is that this echoing, this poetic echoing, is the final consumption, the final eating, so to speak. The eating that leads to the realization that nothing has ever been consumed, actually. There's never been any consumption ever take place. Consumption is entirely non-existent. Never happened. We had a dream of consumption, but it never happened. What we're seeing is a mirage of consumption. And he talks about this glorious mirage of it never leaves strays one iota from its pure spaciousness, from the base. So I hope that it's helpful. It's high art, I would say. Really high art. Now, I don't know what kind of music to put to it, to be honest. And I would suggest you can, if you want to, you can mute the video and then put whatever kind of music you want to it. Or maybe I'll come up with some sort of music. I don't know. It doesn't. But be creative. If there's some music that you helps it, then listen to it. Mute the audio on the video and then listen to this on music as you're watching the video. And you might choose all sorts of different music and watch the video over and over and over. I find, though, that music helps people watch videos. That's why music videos have so many views, is because people are listening to the music, and at the same time, they're getting the video experience. So it's very helpful. But, of course, I cannot use commercial music because it's copyrighted. I mean, YouTube has a very lenient policy in terms, they say, well, it might be blocked in some countries. But still, I don't want, you know, them to pull down my channel and say, well, you use copyrighted material, because it's sort of arbitrary. They might give them an excuse to pull it down. I don't want that to happen. So if I use music, it's Creative Commons music that they have, they have this 150,000 musical selections that you can select, and it's okay to use those because they've have a permission to use it. YouTube does. So otherwise, I might put some nice songs to it. It's a beautiful morning. Da, 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 da. The Young Rascals. Oh my gosh. Grooving, beautiful morning grooving. They made some fabulous music, the Young Rascals, actually. I mean, we were bouncing around in the 60s to the Young Rascals. It's no use just singing around. Find a way. It's like, wow, it's a beautiful morning. It's just. And it gives you this feeling like, I feel echoes of sublimity here, sublimity. But no, that's prohibitive. You can't just use a whole bunch of songs like that, copyrighted songs, and string them together on a video. That's a no-no. So I tried to produce my own music to put the videos in, and you know, it wasn't polished enough. It didn't have the chrome. You need the studio musicians, the producers, all that stuff. They can take a pig and turn it into a homecoming queen. If you have some basics there. So anyway, we have this ambient music, which is kind of cool. Also by slowing down the speed of normal videos to slowing them way down. You get the soundtrack that is really spacey and pretty cool stuff. It sort of feels like spaciousness. Beautiful morning. I think I'll go outside and smile or something like that. Da, 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 da. I didn't learn the lyrics of that song. At one point, I probably knew the lyrics. Hammond B3 organ there. Yeah, there were some echoes in the 60s, I'm telling you. There's no question about it. I mean, thank you, everybody in the 60s, for echoing at least some faint echoes of reality, inferring reality, you know. Greatly appreciated here in 2015, as we are in gangster culture, essentially now. Guerrilla gangster culture. with very lack of inference of reality. Everything's inferring consumption, which is why I say boycott Xmas, because there's nothing but just the inferring of consumption, right? Instead of remembering Christ, which is saying, you don't need to eat God, essentially. They twisted it around backwards. He says, it's useless. It's useless to eat. You can't eat God. And they said, no, we're going to eat you. This is an ancient practice of eating the divinity, the totem, the tribal totem. And this is something they believe that they will become what you eat. So you're eating that. But God is not edible. God is not edible. You can't make God edible. And the Christians think they've made God edible. That is not true. It is not true. I don't want to insult any Christians here. Absolutely not. This is not the purpose here at all. Okay, you should understand that. But I'm just saying from my insight, I'm just passing this along. I love Christians. I really do. They've been very helpful in some ways in the world. But you cannot eat God. It's not possible. God cannot become flesh. It is not possible. This was made up. The ego made this up and built a religion around it. And so I'm helping Christians, recognize, help everybody recognize this. It doesn't matter who. I don't care what someone claims as affiliation. It doesn't matter. The truth is just true. It just is. God is not edible. You cannot eat God. We cannot. There's nothing to consume. Consumption is an illusion. And this came, of course, the Eucharist came from Egyptian religion. And keep in mind that Christianity came from Egyptian religion. The religion of Christianity is really a continuation, extension of Egyptian religion with some pagan dualism. Well, it's just an extension of Egyptian religion with Manichaeism and some others too. But mostly, I mean, just as Virgin Mary is an extension of Isis, the Egyptian goddess Isis. Absolutely, it is. 100%. Man, again, I don't know, Catholics, they'll say, oh, wow, what's this? Well, again, I attend Catholic Mass, and I don't feel I'm insulting anybody, and they don't feel that way towards me, and I'm loving towards them, and I appreciate the love that they bring and all of that. But from the standpoint of truth, there's some mistakes that have been made in order to make people comfortable. Keep in mind that most of the aristocratic women of the Roman Empire were Isis worshippers. She was the number one. That was the number one cult, the cult of Isis. See, Greece. I mean, well, first, Rome took over Egypt, okay, and installed their rulers there. And they're very much influenced by the religions of Egypt. Tremendous cross-cultural influence, and the cult of Isis became extremely well established in the Roman Empire, especially among the women and their aristocratic women. They were fanatics about Isis. So the Christians realized the only way to get protection from Roman persecution was to appeal to these aristocratic women, because as we know, women are the real captains of the ship. I was with this couple recently, very wealthy, powerful couple. Very nice people, actually. And the man said, we're talking about something, and he said, this is a ship. I said, there's a ship, and he said, I'm the captain, and then his wife was there. And then he looks there and says, well, actually, she's the captain, and we kind of, then everyone just stopped and look at each other, and I said, well, maybe you're co-captains, and they kind of, no, I don't think so. She is the captain. And everyone knows. As this man told me, have you ever seen a woman that's really not the captain of the ship? No, they're the captains of the ship. So in Roman times, in order for the Christians to survive, they felt, in order to thrive, and they wanted to keep this message going, so how do we do it? They had to capture the goodwill of the aristocratic women of the Roman Empire. And in order to do this, they incorporated Isis as Mary, the Madonna and Child motif, symbology. They began to say, oh yes, this is really, Mary really is Isis. This is the same. It's the same. And gradually then they said, okay, if you come to church and we'll worship Mary, we'll worship the Madonna and Child, just like you've been doing with Isis, same thing, we'll just change the name. Then the aristocratic women said, "Oh, okay, this is great. This we're okay with that." And then you have this nice liturgy and everything, and gradually they shifted over to Christianity. And when the women, aristocratic women of Rome, shifted over, they just told the men, "Hey, look, this is what we want." And the men says, "Okay, whatever. Just, you know, don't bug me. Stop nagging me. You know, I mean, leave me in peace, will you? Yeah, I just, you know, come on." And they said, "Okay, let's shift over to Christianity. That's what we want." They said, okay, done deal. Whatever you want." This is what really happened in history. So Christianity, the early Christianity, was something very different than what ultimately became Roman Christianity. Very different. It was not, Mary was not part of it. The Isis cult was not really part of it at all. There's nothing in the Bible that suggests Mary wanted some sort of cult around her. Absolutely nothing at all. Jesus did not include her in the pantheon of his apostles that went out. She was not, there's nothing like that. It's all been put in there. And in the 18th, 19th centuries, all this dogma about Mary, et cetera, et cetera. The National Geographic came out. It's Mary, of course. Mary is the face of Christianity now in popular liberal media. Absolutely it is. In the consumption society, the consumer consumption society. It's all about Mary. And Jesus is just some, you know, side issue now. Well, I guarantee you this is not the case. And in A Course in Miracles, Jesus doesn't say one word about Mary or goddess worship or anything like that. Never says a word about it. So it was entirely the mother goddess of nature. Isis is a nature goddess, and the purpose of nature is to consume God. So of course then the Eucharist became this very important idea that you're eating the blood and the flesh of God and consuming God. Whereas what Jesus meant was you need to get familiar with, digest his teachings. Like you eat food and then you let it digest, listen to the profundity of his teachings and be shocked by it, and then digest the shock of it. This is the real path. Digest the shock of the echoes of reality that we have here in this world. Digest that shock. This is what Jesus meant. He didn't mean you're supposed to literally eat his blood and flesh at all. He said the flesh profiteth nothing. It's very clear about it. So again, this is what has happened to Christianity. And while you get a lot of Christians leaving the religion of Christianity, because they say that the dogma is just not right. It's just not right. Now, we don't have to glom onto some other religion or tradition. Just digest non-dual truth. Digest the echoes of reality. Digest the inference of reality. In every which way you can, it's perfectly okay. I have no trouble with Longchampa or Ananda Maima or Ramana Maharshi or these echoes. I say, "Oh, it's all welcome. This helps. Let me digest this. It's just a reminder. It's an echo of reality. Thank you. That's what we need. We don't need a particular label on it and say, "Well, this is a Christian echo or this is a Hindu echo." No, it's just an echo. It is an echo. It is an inference. That's all. Reality is. There's no label for reality. There's no label. You don't say, "Well, this is a Christian reality." No, it just is. It's not consumable. It can't be eaten. Labels can be eaten, right? But there's no label for reality. There's no definition for reality. It is the isness. It cannot be eaten. So Jesus used that eating as a metaphor. Whereas you see the food, you eat the food, you taste the food, you get the flavor, and then just let it digest and don't think about it in your stomach. Just let it just sit there quietly and let it digest. This is a banquet. That's what they did. They ate. Then they hung around, listened to music, talked, and let it digest. This is what he was saying. Let the shock of recognition and familiarity, echoes, inference of reality, get the flavor, get the taste. Fill yourself with it, and then when it's enough, say, "Oh, I can't eat anymore." It's like food. You say, "I just can't. The wow's so strong. I can't take anymore." Then let a digestive process. Let the reverberations of the bell gradually subside. Just relax. Be patient. Don't be in a hurry. You can't hurry digestion, can you? He was using it as a metaphor for the spiritual path. He didn't mean it literally at all. And the literalists, of course, took over and lost the symbology of it. So this is history. This is what happened. And you know, you look in hindsight, you say, of course that's what happened. So again, we're not trying to impress the ego of what good Christians we are, what good Hindus we are, what Buddhists, whatever. We're not trying to impress the ego. We're just humbly absorbing the shock of echoes of reality and the inferences of reality. We're just putting ourselves through the mill here. You know, it's the work. It's a workout. It's a workout. I'm up there past midnight, almost 1 o'clock in the morning last night, putting this video together. I worked hours and hours and hours and hours and hours, and you'll see, it was just you know, intense work. So I'm working out. We're working out. That's what we do. We're spiritual workout artists. Geniuses, spiritual workout geniuses. You have to be a spiritual workout genius here. As in this mirage, in this hallucination, in this dream. Spiritual workout geniuses. Be a spiritual workout genius. Nothing else will work. Nothing else will suffice. And there weren't enough of them. There were some in Jesus' time, absolutely. Early Christianity was quite extraordinary. There were spiritual workout geniuses then, but politics ultimately supervened. All the arguments, the thing of the Roman Empire, the Romans basically said, they were pretty ecumenical, and they had a lot of different religions. They said, whatever, just don't cause us problems. The early Christians are mostly Jewish in Alexandria. There's a lot of them, and for some reason the Jews got in conflict arose. I don't know if it was a Jewish thing or whatever it was, but they wanted things to be the way they wanted them to be, and a lot of conflict arose, especially in Alexandria, which was the biggest city in the world at the time, most center really of power. But the administration was from Rome, and they just said, "Hey, listen, you know, you're attacking and burning churches. You're too fanatical." Because the Old Testament, the Jews were very fanatical about their religious beliefs, right? And if you didn't adhere to them, you know, it was an anathema. I mean, the law, to the tiniest little thing, if you did anything wrong, you know, you're impure, this is terrible. So they had this impurity laws, and they got so upset towards the pagans and what, you know, they got, so there were a lot of conflicts in the cities and a lot of acrimony, and the emperor, and of course all the aristocratic ladies who lived the life of leisure and wonderful, you know, just, they said, "Hey, you know, emperor, what are you doing? I don't want all the distress. I want to go visit Alexandria. I want to enjoy. There's trouble there. Come on, you know, do something about it." So the emperor said, "Okay, look, got to stop all this conflict and bickering. I'm tired of this. There's so much bickering." And he said, the emperor said, "Get your house in order. Stop causing disturbance in the empire." That's all. You know, that's all the emperor really wanted. They're very pragmatic people, these administrators and bureaucrats. They tend to be pragmatic in certain ways, some of them. God forbid the fanatics get in charge in that way. But so the spiritual practicing geniuses, they pretty much fled out into the desert to get away from all this Old Testament law sort of stuff. They said, "Hey, we just want to do what Jesus told us to do and get used, you know, and yet you're like Old Testament. Now you got to sacrifice. We have to have this. You have to atone for this sin and this thing and all this Old Testament stuff." It's just, wow, this is not where it's at. So most of the church fathers were these hermits and anchorites and monks, you know, that renouncing the world and the very holy. They were very holy and miracles abounded. There's no question about it. But ultimately, the politics won out. And the emperor says, get a codified Council of Chalcedon and get, I want to see a constitution for this religion, folks. And you better get it now. So Constantine put the pressure on him. They finally came up with something, you know, sort of like a legalistic document saying, okay, two natures, dualistic nature, hypostatic union, somehow those are reconciled, and anyone doesn't believe this is an anathema and a heretic, and we banish them. And the emperor said, okay, good. You have to manage your own house for me. You know, I don't want to do it for you. So that's when the church started getting rough and cracking heads on various Christians that didn't adhere to this political dualistic settlement that they came up with to try to appease everybody. And it's been pretty much downhill in a lot of ways ever since. There's still been positive traditions of holiness and monasticism and doing what Jesus, allowing the echoes of reality to be ingested in the mind. There's still, but it's gradually, you know, it lost its momentum. Now you just have numbers, but no, you know, quantity, but no quality is what the problem is. Really. Quantity, but not quality. The quality is very superficial right now. Very superficial. And of course, you can still maybe find echoes of the potency of Christianity. Some people can find it. Absolutely. It was very potent in the beginning. Just as Buddhism was very potent in the beginning, too. Very potent. Now you have a lot of politics. A lot of politics is involved. The world's become a political animal, hasn't it? It's now into consumerism. Fanatically into consumerism. So Christmas is the time we're supposed to remember Christ. Why did Christ come here? To remind us of what? And we're supposed to stop our consumerism in Christmas. It's a time really of fasting. It should be a time of fasting. And that's why we give to the poor, the needy. We go without so others who are needy can have some. Instead, it's become this food orgy and consumer orgy. Really, it's an orgy, a consumer orgy. It's repulsive. It is so extraordinarily repulsive. But because we're in this habit now of consumerism, okay, well, pragmatically, I present something to be consumed by the spirit. There's nothing wrong. Because we have this habit, we can't just drop the whole habit of consuming. We think we need to consume, we think. So consume the echoes of reality, consume the inferences of reality, keep getting familiar with that. So I tried to make these videos available. I don't know why the Holy Spirit is not directing more to watch. This is something I don't understand, but I keep working at it. That's all I can say. Do not look at images of war and deprivation and consumption and all the fear and stuff. This does not get any of us familiar with a higher realm, death-free realm. It does not. It does not in any way help us. In fact, it harms us. It pulls us down. It delays our entry into the death-free realm. It delays it. Ultimately, we have no choice. We will all dwell for a while in the death-free realm, higher realm, whatever you want to call it. But we can delay that quite a bit in this culture, and the world culture is delaying it very severely. So don't watch the news, don't watch this stuff. Only watch that which is beautiful and uplifting, beautiful palm trees and fountains and gorgeous scenery and beautiful music and graphics and whatever it is that you just feel, oh, this is so sublime. This is so ineffably sublime. I wish I dwelled in such a place. This is helpful. This is helpful. And again, don't anybody take offense. It's not, I'm not, the purpose here is not to attack anybody or cause anyone to take offense. I'm just pointing out the rationale and the overall big picture of the situation and the pragmatic nature of it and the importance. Now, if you say you're a Christian and you want Christian themes, that's great. Then get Sublime Christian themes. I'll make a video for you. I try to. Sure, absolutely. I try to make videos for Buddhists, for those who have that leaning, for Christians, for Hindus. And I leave it at that for now, because of course there is this irritation in the world with Islam. Islam is quite irritated, and so they tend to be right at this point rather volatile, in a volatile mood. I don't want to tread on any toes there at all, in spite, you know, meaning well. Sometimes when people are quite agitated, they may not take it that way, so that's fine. I respect that tradition too, absolutely. Great tradition, actually. Right now, they are agitated and volatile, and I'm not impugning the reasons for it. They may have a great distaste for the consumer society that we have, and feel that it's very bad, which it is a bad way to go for sure. But I feel that there's better ways to deal with it than how it's being dealt with. But again, so I don't want to tread any toes there. So I pretty much stick with Christianity, Hinduism, Buddhism, and everything else that can be brought, can be used in certain themes. And again, it may be helpful. You don't say, well, I have to have this theme, I have to have the labels there, the cross must be there. That's not the point of the art and the help. Is the echo there? Is the echo there? Is the inference there? Is the inference there of reality? Am I feeling something sublime? Am I getting familiar with something sublime, gradually familiar with it? This is what's important. The death-free realm is the death-free realm. There's not some label you get there and say, Jesus Christ welcomes you to Christian death, the Christian death-free realm. It's not like that. It's not like that. It's like you're welcome to the realm where there's no consumption has ever taken place. This tree has never fallen down and rotted. This bush has never fallen down and, you know, died and withered. This flower has never withered and been consumed by this consumption mechanism we call nature. Nothing has ever suffered consumption there. Nothing has ever been consumed there. I've been there. I've seen it. I've experienced it. I know this is true. There's no consumption that's ever taken place there. And you just say, yeah, I like this. Wow, this reminds me of something. Let the reminder sink in. Don't say, I need to put it into a consumable format for the ego. This Pac-Man ego to jump, 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 jump. I need to eat this. I need to eat this. I need to eat everything. We need more eaters. I have more work to do. I will try to do some more. We'll see if I can get this pipeline going for you. I know the talk, excuse me, I know the talks are wonderful. I enjoy doing them. I'll do both. I feel the talks are very helpful. I think most people appreciate those because they can see that, you know, someone is in the same boat, and we're all in the same boat here, and we're struggling through the same struggles, and we're seeing the same stuff. And that's very helpful, very helpful. But again, don't underestimate the importance of getting this inference of beauty and the sublime, and feel like, wow, I'm getting used to this. The ineffable, the abstract ineffableness. So I'm eager to see what I can do to help out with this. It takes a lot of work, a lot of focus, a lot of determination. And I said, but don't ask me how I do it. Let the artist take care of that. Let the artist, spiritual art, there's spiritual art here. Let the artist struggle through that. That's what they're capable of. It it just takes a willingness, really, to, and an absolute saying, this has to happen. This has to happen. I have to give birth to this. It's like giving birth. It's saying that this is super important. This has to happen. This will happen. I can do it. I will do it. It's already done. I've already done it. This is my attitude. I can do it. I will do it. I've already done it. I have a long history of working with sublime art, stretching back incarnations. So I know how it's done. I can do it. I will do it. I've already done it. But it really has to be this sense that this has to be born into the world. And then let the Holy Spirit take care of the rest. And there's a number of hoops and jumping through this and jumping through that and disappointments and dead ends and frustrations and struggles. And, you know, most people just give up and say, wow. But we'll see what we can do here. But again, the Holy Spirit reminded me in a very uncertain terms, a very, very certain terms. How do you say it? Very certain, you might say, not uncertain terms. Very, in no uncertain terms, the way you put it, in no uncertain terms, meaning no lack of certainty. Rocks are coming. They're coming. Jumped over them. That was pretty, very interesting situation. I can actually leap now. I actually practice jumping on my toes, jumping, jump, 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 jump. I can actually jump. I jumped. Before, 104 days ago, I couldn't have jumped. Which was okay. But we need to be able to jump right now. Make the jump. Be able to make the jump. Rocks are coming. Be able to make the jump. So, I'm open to everything the Holy Spirit has to offer. So let me get working on this. Let me get some more material for you. And just enjoy. Consume it. But this is a spiritual consumption issue. Just consume this is fine. But it's you're working towards the final consumptions. Consume this until you realize, I don't need to consume. In fact, nothing's ever been consumed. I am everything. Everything is everything. Nothing can be consumed. Everything is everything. But don't take a intellectual position on it with the ego says, oh yeah. No, we need to do the final consumption here. Just like the death-free realm is the final realm. The final illusion that dispels all our illusions and makes them unnecessary, then ultimately makes itself unnecessary. It's a continuity issue here. So, by all means, partake of the graphics. I know there's some who really, really love them and appreciate them. So, I will try to keep putting out these graphics and make them as beautiful as possible, sublime as possible. So you get the flavor, 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 get the flavor. And don't worry if you're not out there impressing the ego. You're not in Time magazine, you're not in these magazines, you're not in the list of the 100 most spiritual people in the world. You don't make the list. Don't worry about it. It's not the list you need to make, it's the death-free realm. It's jumping over the rocks that you need to make. That's what you need to make. And that's the make or break situation, not the ego saying how great you are. So I know the viewers are great from my standpoint, absolutely. From the Holy Spirit's standpoint, absolutely. Those who pay attention to truth are there. They truly are blessed right now. Their blessing is coming soon. Everyone is blessed, but they try to delay the recognition of this. And again, it can be quite severe delay. This gangster culture we have now is very severe delay. It's just makes you, you know, want to vomit, actually. And so just stay away from it. Seriously, stay away from it. Put put your attention on the opposite. You know, what is really, really sublime. Put your attention on what is sublime. Sublime, sublime, sublime. Okay. Let's see if anything else. Keep in mind, in the death-free realm, the focus is not on bodies, not on people, not on personalities. It's on the fact that nothing's ever been consumed here in this entire realm. There's never been one iota of consumption ever take place. And you just sit there and you just, wow. All right? Wow, this is really extraordinary. We're not worried about playing games with one another or interaction and personality interaction or anything like that. No. Because, of course, everyone else there is having the same shock, the same realization. Wow. Nothing's ever been consumed here. Wow. This is quite extraordinary. This reminds me so powerfully of something. It's a powerful reminder. So you just sit. Just sit quietly. Sit quietly. So, God willing, this will pick up steam somehow. I'll get back down to the desert. There's sublime places there, really. Especially in the wintertime, when they plant all the flowers. It's like you feel you're in a different universe, actually. Different realm. And no, we don't want the ego to put us into a consumable. We don't want the ego to consume us. In fact, we disallow it. Absolutely disallow it. We will not be the divinity that comes so that we can be eaten. Absolutely not. That's prohibited. As Jesus said, told the carpenters, those are those who have some contact with Jesus, you don't have to be crucified. Nobody has to be crucified. He only did it for just to show the final weary step of the ego's path is nothing at all. Nothing, just futile. He said, but nobody needs to do this. I just wanted to give this, show the ego the futility of it. Nobody else has to be crucified. We don't have to be crucified. Certainly don't have to be consumed. Absolutely not. No harm, no harm. We refuse to be harmed. We refuse to be for nature to consume us. We absolutely refuse to be. I'm not here to be consumed by nature. Okay, plain and simple. To say I am not here to be consumed by nature. I absolutely will not be consumed by nature. I cannot be consumed by nature. I will not be consumed by nature. I'm already never being consumed by nature. And if you're astonished by this, realize this comes from first, the Holy Spirit, secondly, the great teachers, okay? Jesus Christ, Longchenpa, Nandamayama, Ramana Maharshi, etc. The great teachers. This is why anyone can say what this and speak this way, etc. This is the only reason why really, ultimately it's all within us. And I should mention Marie Watts also. She's not as known as the great teachers, but she actually was quite extraordinary. And there are others that are not as so well known. So it comes from them. It comes from them. And ultimately it comes from God. Right? It comes from God. Everything that we are comes from God. We're an extension of God, as Jesus says. Here in this world, we think of a child being born, that it's separate from its parents. But in God creating us, God extended God as itself, and we remain, the creations of God remain in God. They're not separate. Not some separate entity that, no, it's different. Here, what we've done here is a picture of separation. This is not how creation is, actually. So, the truth comes from God, which is what we are. We're an extension of God. So, of course, the perfect truth is within us. But those who broke through the continuity, who evaporated the continuity fear enough so that they could experience this, then they can, you know, encourage us. So the encouragement has come from all these great teachers. It encourages me to speak up. That's why. Without them, no, could not do it. Lack of encouragement. This is why so many are not able to do it. They have a lack of encouragement. That's all it is. It's within them. They know it's within them, but they just, I just can't quite seem to, you know, I just don't feel, it's a lack of encouragement. I've gotten a lot of encouragement because I subjected myself to it. Encouragement. I said, yeah, let me get the encouragement here. It's needed. It's needed here. Never more so than now. So this Christmas season, again, is a reminder of non-consumption, that God cannot be consumed. Instead, we're going full blast with consumption of goods, of services, of food, of every type of beverage, you name it, whatever we consume, it's a massive orgy of consumption. Now we just call it the holidays, meaning the consumption holidays. I say, why even just leave it up to Christmas? Let's expand it to all these other issues, and we'll just say this whole block of time, let's just make December into the new year, this massive orgy of consumption, which is exactly opposite of what Jesus wants us to do. Exactly opposite. Exactly opposite. So it's the ego, which is our delaying mechanism. What are we delaying? Well, we're delaying realization. We can't be eaten. We can't be consumed. We can't be harmed. We can't die. We're delaying glory and bliss and peace and love, and we're delaying all of that. And instead, fear, death, misery, suffering. We remain in that. And so, truly, this is not what anyone really wants. And yet, this horrible culture has arisen from the egomaniacs and our own continuity fear. And our own lack of assurance that we've been lazy. We wanted to impress the ego, and so we've been lazy and spiritually lazy because we've been spent trying to impress the ego instead of listening to the Holy Spirit. It's on us. It's on us. We've been lazy. The world's been very lazy. We get lazy, you go into gangster culture, plain and simple. And then, of course, it's, it's excuses. No, gangster culture is fine. It's everyone else is wrong, right? More and more, you feel you're being eaten alive, aren't you? Doesn't this world give you a feeling of being eaten alive? Of course it does. Of course it does. Or being eaten, the sense of a feeling of being eaten alive. And the Californians realize that now. Oh my gosh, we're being eaten alive here. I don't want to be eaten. I gotta eat. I gotta be the eater and not the eaten, right? You got all these great white sharks now everywhere. We're in a shark tank. I did it. Silicon Valley's a shark tank. Where's a shark? What are sharks? They're the eating machines. They're consuming machines. Everyone's afraid of being eaten, so they try to eat others so they can get more powerful. It's the whole model of the world is extraordinarily decadent, wicked, regressive, repressive, regressive. Delay-oriented, extraordinarily delay-oriented here. So let us lighten the mood here with Christmas. Let us truly lighten the mood. We're going to the death-free realm where there's no consumption whatsoever. Let us prepare for that. Let us prepare for that. There's nature. It's beautiful nature, more beautiful than anything we've ever seen here. But the point of it is nothing's ever been consumed there. There's not these chemical, biochemical, organic cycles. Nothing like that. And yet everything still feels, it's all natural, it feels natural, it feels like this is a tree, but my gosh, the tree's never fallen down, never rotted, no beetles have ever borne into it, no dead branches have ever happened, nothing, it's not lost, nothing's been consumed. The seeds, the fruit, everything is there, it's not going through any cycles of consumption. Everything's beautiful, immaculately beautiful. You could say Immaculate Virgin, death-free realm. You could even look at it that way. If Jesus said, this is my mother, he'd be pointing us to the death-free realm. ultimately pointing us to pure spaciousness, which is beyond even the mother concept, actually. But the important thing is to get away from the male-female symbology, the mother symbology, all this stuff, and look at it pragmatically. It's no consumption's taking place. This is what you notice. Hey, it's a nice flower. Look at those flowers. My gosh, they're beautiful. They're perfect. Then you look and you look, kind of look around, and it says, there's nothing, nothing looks sick. Nothing has fallen. Nothing's broken. Flower looks perfect. I don't see any wilted. It gradually seeps into you. Where's all the dead stuff? Where's all the things being consumed and broken down? And I don't see any. It just sort of gradually seeps in. You say, wow, well, what is this place? That was my experience. So now we have a much better, much clearer understanding and familiarity with the death-free realm. I'm passing this along to everybody. It's very important. The Holy Spirit keeps emphasizing with a hammer, rocks are coming. Rocks are coming. Whatever that means, it's not good. It's a delay mechanism. A severe delay mechanism is approaching rapidly. So, I am already prepared. Have this attitude and make it real. Make it real. All right. Very great. How we do? We went 2 hours. That's awesome. That's enough for this one, though. Okay. Keep watching and make your consumption the sublime, so that will get us into the realm of non-consumption, death-free realm. Okay. Make your consumption sublime. Stop consuming the junk of the world. Consume.